evening and welcome to Tinkering with Etkelar. I was giving it my best this past week, but I still have not quite finished the wire recorder. The case is done, yes, but the electronics... Well, the capacitors are pretty much shot and need replacing, and while I was at it, I decided to measure a few of the resistors as well. Let's just say the tolerance is an order of magnitude out. More like 100% instead of 10. So I have to postpone the electronics until the replacements arrive. After finishing up the last bits of the case, I focused on the mechanical parts for the time being. They need some TLC too. Taking it apart is an exercise in find the hidden screw and guess the type. Flathead? Phillips? Torx? One of those grub screws broke my flathead screwdriver. Oof! Torx after all. All the moving parts had really nasty grease around them. I think it wasn't green originally. Yuck! Quite a large number of parts is held in place with rivets. I tried to keep those in place, but it would have prevented some major cleanup on the copper surface. I decided to drill out the ones that I could easily replace with some screws. Thank you. all the metal parts are oxidized. I tried various cleaning and solvent agents, but nothing would get through to the base metal. Sandpaper it is then. Lots and lots of sandpaper. In an attempt to keep it from going dull again, I brushed on a thin coat of clear lacquer. And yes, I will make sure that the electrical contacts actually make contact to ground the chassis. The tape, wire head seems to be soldered in. The socket is held in place by one of those pesky one-way clips, so I desoldered the wires to push the pins through the socket. Only to find out that the pins are not part of the head and that I just disassembled a plug. The head has a nice visible set of coils on it, and all the wires are soldered into the hollow pins. I had to carefully remove them just so I could properly clean the head all around. Spools were also a bit grimy, so I gave them a quick sanding and added a fresh coat of paint. Reassembly is going nice. For the drilled out rivets, I used some M3 brass screws that Hurgotron suggested to me as a replacement. Yes, it slightly changes the look, but in a good way, I think. Moving parts get some grease, which is easier said than done, since most of those are riveted too. I used a piece of paper to slide a glob of grease in between the metal parts and exercised the joint to spread it out. Some parts need to be attached in sequence so they don't obscure one another. It was a bit of trial and error to make everything fit together again. The self-centering bearings are spring-loaded spheres with holes for the axles. These bearings seem to be oil-light, as in don't use any lubrication, bushings, but the service manual for the device calls for occasional light oil, so some drips of oil make sure that they turn smooth and nice. After attaching all the metal bits and pieces again, I made sure that every wheel turns as expected. There is one electrical component that I need to add though, the motor switch at the bottom. It's an open design, literally. Yes, that switch carries main voltage and turns on the motor. The second contact is for the erase head, making sure that it's only active in play mode. Both stop and rewind will keep it disconnected. I got myself a 110V 60Hz power source to test out the device. And then the service manual mentions that it would also run on 50Hz, just slightly slower, so a regular transformer would have been enough. Oof. After cleaning the power cord, it is time to give it a test run. Fire extinguisher at the ready. It works! Yes! But how? Let's have a quick rundown of how things connect. The motor is sitting in the base plate with a teeter-totter arrangement held in place by two springs. This allows it to be tilted over to the rewind or play position with a cam that pushes against the spring-loaded lever. The play control lever has another set of cams on it, which operate the brake mechanics. Both of the wheel brakes have three positions. A soft brake, which is basically tensioning the wire during transport, and a hard brake, which is stopping the wheel. The third position is the open position to prevent drag on the driven wheel. The wheel that holds the wire spool has a ball and spring arrangement to provide some hold down force. On to the tape. Darn! Wire head. It is mounted on a moving peg that slides up and down, making sure that the wire will be wound on the spools in an orderly fashion. The movement is driven by a worm drive on the take-up spool axle and a cam and lever assembly. And this concludes this episode. I hope you enjoyed it. See you next time. I used some M3 brass screws that Hugo adding a German word in an English sentence is not easy.